In my previous lecture, I talked about the glycolysis and how ATP is being generated. So now I'll move ahead a little bit further. We will talk about the next cycle, which is the citric acid cycle. So the early biochemical steps in the respiration of glucose are the same as that of glycolysis. So all the steps from glucose to pyruvate are the same. So in fermentation, pyruvate is reduced and converted into products that are excreted, such as ethanol or lactic acid. However, these products are waste for the microorganism, but they are quite useful for the growing industry. In respiration, pyruvate is oxidized to carbon dioxide. The pathway by which pyruvate is completely oxidized to carbon dioxide is called citric acid cycle or Krebs cycle. So in this, pyruvate is the first decarboxylated, leading to the production of carbon dioxide, NADH, and the energy-rich substance acetyl-CoA. Now, the acetyl group of acetyl-CoA then combines with the fourth carbon component, which is oxaloacetate, forming the sixth carbon compound, citric acid, which is the first compound of this cycle, because of which it is also known as the citric acid cycle. Now, after this, a series of reaction follows, which leads to the addition of two CO2 molecules, three more NADH, and one FDH are formed. Ultimately, the oxaloacetate is regenerated, which is again ready to accept an acetyl molecule. So let's have a look at this particular cycle here. So here we have this acetyl CoA, which is a two carbon molecule from which CoA is removed. And then we have this acetyl, which binds to this four carbon chain molecule, oxaloacetate, leads to the formation of C6 molecule. From modification of this, ultimately leads to isocitrate. From here, one molecule of CO2 is being released. And there is reduction of this NAD to NADH. And ultimately, what we get is a 5-carbon compound. From there, again, we have conversion of one NADH and get a C4 compound. This C4 ultimately it keeps on converting from one molecule to another, and what we get is the oxaloacetate. In this process, one FADH2 and NH2 is reduced. So if we look at the energetics balance sheet, that is how much molecules of ATP are generated. So in glycolysis, what we have is we have two pyruvate molecules are generated, which enters the Krebs cycle. Two ATP molecules are generated and two NADH are generated. So if we calculate this, two ATP, then total we have two ATP and two NADH equals to six ATP. So we have eight ATP molecules which are generated. And in the citric acid cycle, pyruvate leads to formation of three CO2 molecules, four NADH, one FADH2 and one GTP. So this one GTP is equals to one ATP, four NADH equals to 12 ATP, one FADH equals to two ATP. So in all we have 15 ATP. Since two pyruvate molecules are generated, so we'll multiply by two. So we'll have 30 molecules. Eight are from the previous, so we have 38 ATP molecules. So now we'll move to the another part of this lecture, which is the catabolic diversity. So microbial cells, they generate energy other than by fermentation and aerobic respiration. So although we saw that aerobic respiration and the fermentation, they are going in wide variety of microorganisms. But microorganisms, they are found everywhere. They are found in conditions where both of these processes are not possible. So these are anaerobic respiration, chemolithotrophy, or phototrophy. anaerobic respiration, it usually takes place under anoxic conditions. That is where the availability of oxygen is not there. So electron acceptors other than oxygen can be used to support respiration in certain prokaryotes. So there are other molecules which can be used. For example, nitrate, it could be reduced to nitrite by E. coli or to nitrogen by Pseudomonas species. So this kind of species is most common in the leguminous plant where we see nitrogen fixation. Then we have this ferric ion, it could be reduced to ferrous by a Geobacter species. Sulfate could be reduced to hydrogen sulfide by D-sulfophorbido species. Now this reduction leads to the generation of proton motive force. That generation of proton motive force could lead to the synthesis of ATP. So just let's imagine that we have this, look at this pictorial of chemoorganotropy. So what we have is a organic compound which can usually be degraded by fermentation or CO2 in availability of oxygen where the respiration takes place. Now we can have another molecules like sulfur, nitrate, sulfur or organic acceptors where oxygen is absent. So there also generation of proton motive force leads to generation of ATP or NADPH. Now there is another category of microorganisms which is chemolithotropy. So this chemolithotropy uses inorganic chemicals. So previous one they were using organic, but here they are using inorganic chemicals as electron donors itself. So these inorganic electron donors include nitrogen sulfide, hydrogen gas, ferric and ammonia. So these molecules, they are kind of responsible for the generation of ATP and NADH. So chemolithotropic metabolism is typically aerobic and this begins with the oxidation of inorganic electron donor. So these chemolithotrophs, they use carbon dioxide as a source and also therefore autotrophs. Now the third category is the phototroph. So these use light as an energy source in the process of photosynthesis. So this light mediated ATP synthesis is called photophosphorylation. So most autotrophs, they use energy conserved in ATP for the assimilation of CO2 as the carbon source for biosynthesis called the photoautotrophs. So some of these phototrophs, they use organic compound as a carbon source with light as the energy. So they can be called as photoautotrophs. So look at this particular picture here. So like this electron transfer, so we can have electron donors as H2O or H2OS. So this electron transport, this electrons which are donated, they could generate the proton motive force and have the reducing power or the torque generation, which could lead to the production of ATP, and reducing power could lead to generation of NADP or NADPH. These ATPs, they could be used for the reduction of organic compounds for the biosynthesis in case of phototrophy, or simply use of CO2 for the synthesis using in phototrophy. So now we'll talk about the second phase, that is the anabolism. So anabolism is the biosynthesis of the building blocks of the four classes of molecules. So what are these four classes? These are sugars, which are responsible for the larger molecules, carbohydrates or polysaccharides. Then we have this amino acids, which are for proteins, nucleotides, which are also known for synthesis of nucleic acids, and fatty acids, which are for larger molecules of fats. So metabolism is regulated by control of the enzyme activity. So several kind of enzymes are there which are leading to the anabolism activity, that is the production of larger molecules from simple units, and this is tightly regulated. Specific enzymes are responsible for the synthesis of specific molecules. So let's have a look at the biosynthesis of sugars and polysaccharides. So in bacteria, the sugars and polysaccharides play pivotal role. So one of the major role is the formation of a peptidoglycan cell wall in the bacteria. So cells, they store carbon and energy reserve in the form of larger polymers, which are as polysaccharides such as glycogen and starch. So these glycogen and starch, they are made of sugars which are glycosides. They are usually glucose or glucose derivative molecules. Also, it's not only that hexoses are there, some pentoses sugars are also there. Polysaccharides, they are synthesized from activated form of hexoses such as uridine diphosphoglucose or adenosine diphosphoglucose. So look at the structure of this molecule. So this is what we have is a hexose ring, which is via 2-phosphate linkage is bound to a pentose ring. Then we have this adenine. So that's the structure of uridine diphosphoglucose. So ADPG or the adenosine diphosphate is the precursor of glycogen. UDPG, it is the precursor of N-acetyl glucosamine and N-acetyl muriatic acid, which is a major component of the bacterial cell wall, that is the peptidoglycan, or it is a major follower polysaccharide, which is component of the gram-negative bacteria. This another method which is called the gluconeogenesis. So it is the synthesis of glucose when the cell is growing on other carbon compounds. So usually, if glucose is available, then it doesn't need to synthesize glucose. But if glucose is not available, then it needs to synthesize glucose. So there are a lot of other compounds which are available. So one of the most common is the phosphoenolpyruvate. So it is the intermediate of glycolysis as the starting material. So this is what we have. We can have a variety of molecules, C2, C3, C4 or C5. Different compounds could be there. They enter the citric acid cycle, leading to the formation of oxaloacetate and then ultimately phosphoenolpyruvate, which then kind of converts into glucose 6-phosphate after a couple of reactions. So pentoses, they are both nucleic acid synthesis. They are formed by the decarboxylation of hexoses such as glucose 6-phosphate. So this glucose 6-phosphate, there is kind of liberation, release of one CO2 molecule, which leads to the formation of ribulose 5-phosphate. And ultimately, the rearrangement leads to the formation of ribose 5-phosphate. This ribophosphate only leads to the formation of ribonucleotides. And ultimately, these ribonucleotides could be used for the formation of RNA. Now, these ribonucleotides, they could be oxidized by NADPH to deoxyribonucleotides, which act as a backbone or a primary molecule for the DNA synthesis. Now, this the 2' hydroxyl of the sugar of the ribonucleotides is converted to formation of ribonucleotides. So biosynthesis of amino acids and nucleotides. The monomers in protein are the amino acids, whereas in the nucleic acids are the nucleotides. So we have this citric acid cycle or the F cycle and the glycolysis. They provide the carbon skeleton for the most amino acids. So what we get in the citric acid cycle, alpha ketobutyrate or the oxaloacetate. Now these alpha ketobutyrate and the oxaloacetate, they are responsible or they are kind of backbone for the synthesis of different amino acids. For example, butyrate can convert into glutamate, and that leads to the synthesis of proline, glutamine, and arginine. So this family of 3 amino acids are synthesized from glutamate. aspartate family resources of another 5. Similarly, in the glycolase also, we have pyruvate, 3 phosphoglycerate, and this orismate. So they lead to synthesis of different amino sources. Similarly, in a way, what I mean to say is that septic acid cycle and glycolysis, they are responsible. They the precursor intermediate molecules which are produced in septic acid or glycolysis are responsible for the synthesis of different amino acids. The amino group of amino acids derived from inorganic nitrogen source of the environment, which is ammonia. So there are two major pathways for ammonia acid assimilation or incorporation in the bacteria, and they are catalyzed by the two different set of enzymes. Number one is the glutamate dehydrogenase. Another one is the glutamine synthase. So let's look at this particular reaction. Is alpha keto butyrate combines with the amino in the presence of glutamate, and the sedation of NADH leads to glutamate, where this amino is attached. And this glutamate with the amino combines with another amino acid. This is ATP is used up in the absence, in the presence of glutamate synthesis, and we have this glutamate. So this alpha butyrate leads to synthesis of glutamate. Similarly, we can have this glutamate combining with the oxaloacetate in the presence of transaminase. So this transaminase transfer the amino group, and it kind of leads to the transfer of amino group from one amino acid leads to the formation of aspartate. The third one is the glutamate synthase. So this glutamine, which is already having two amino groups, reacts with the alpha butyrate, and this oxidation of NADH, which leads to the formation of 2-glutamate. Monomers for nucleic acids, that is the nucleotide synthesis. So as all of us know, monomers are the purines and the pyrimidines. So purines, they are kind of constructed atom by atom from several carbon and nitrogen sources, including CO2. So this is what we have, like different kind of atoms, they are arranged, and the initially this arrangement is, which is kind of, you know, the primary molecule or the first purine synthesized is the inosinic acid. Now this inosinic acid is a base or a precursor for the synthesis of adenine and guanine. Similarly, in the pyrimidine synthesis, we have this orotic acid, and we have this uridylate. So this uridylate, it acts as a precursor molecule for the synthesis of thymine, cytosine, and uricil. So this, what we call as this orotic acid, is combined with the pentose sugar here. Biosynthesis of fatty acids. So fatty acids, they are biosynthesized from 2 carbon atoms at a time with the help of a protein called the acyl carrier protein, or the simple ACP. So ACP holds the growing fatty acid chain as it is being synthesized and releases it once it has reached its final length. So in a way, this whole molecule, this acetyl molecule, you can see it's attached to ACP, and this malonyl kind of keep on adding to it. So after every cycle, you see there's an increment in the molecules. So from this 2, we have 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. So ultimately the 16 is the malonate. So depending on what kind of fatty acid is required, the chain keeps on increasing. So usually the low temperature promotes the growth of or the biosynthesis of shorter chain fatty acids, and the high temperature usually promotes the long chain fatty acids. So branched chain fatty acids, they are biosynthesized using an initiating molecule that contains the branched chain fatty acids. So it depends. So what are the precursor fatty chain molecules that will determine the whole large molecule? Lipid biosynthesis. So in cells of bacteria and eukarya, fatty acids they are added with the glycerol. That's what we call as the lipids. For simple lipids, we call as the triglycerides. So all the three glycerol carbons, they are esterified with the fatty acids. However, in complex lipids, one of the carbon atom in glycerol contains molecule of phosphate, ethanolamine, carbohydrate, or some other polar substance. In archaea, the membrane lipids contains 5-tenyl, that is C15, or bi-5-tenyl, that is C30 side chain instead of fatty acids. Now, it is because of this glycerol backbone that the glycerol membrane has the polar groups. So, these polar groups are sugar, phosphate, or sulfate, and that facilitates the formation of a typical membrane, that is the hydrophobic interior and the hydrophilic outside. So, now we'll come to the regulation of the activity of biosynthetic enzymes. So, there are two modes of enzyme regulation in the cells. Number one is the controlling the amount of an enzyme. So this amount of enzyme that is usually it's fully controlled. And the second is the control of the activity. So we can have either very low amount of enzyme or large amount of enzyme, or if let's say the controlling not only the amount, the overall activity of the enzyme can also be controlled. In prokaryotes, the amount of enzyme is regulated at the gene level. So it's the upper regulation and the down regulation of the genes which controls the amount of a given enzyme. So inhibition of enzyme activity is a result of either covalent or non-covalent change in its structure. So it is quite possible that the enzyme which becomes more active or less active, it will be depending on the covalent modification. So if let's say enzyme is active at some conformation, if there is any kind of covalent or non-covalent changes occur, it is quite possible that it comes in. The major means of controlling enzyme activity is by feedback inhibition. So this mechanism temporarily shuts off the reaction in an entire biosynthetic pathway. Also, this feedback inhibition is irreversible. So let's have a look at this particular mechanism here. So we have a starting substrate. So from here, we could have a couple of intermediates and we can have a couple of enzymes here. So if the end product is in large excess amount, and now this large excess amount is now it's not required in the bacteria. So now this end product could act as a feedback inhibition and it could block the activity of enzyme. So now once the activity of enzyme is blocked, there will be no formation of intermediate first. So if no intermediate first, then subsequent step will automatically be reduced. In a way, the sufficient availability of the end product dictates how much this whole synthesis will be there. If this amount goes down, then the inhibition will be stopped. If there is no inhibition, then again enzyme A will be active. It will keep on following the same pathway and it will synthesize intermediate 1, 2, 3. Okay, so there's another one, the mechanism of allosteric inhibition. So let's imagine this is an enzyme where we can have two sites. Number one is the active site. So this is the site where the substrate binds. Another one is the allosteric site. So this allosteric site is the site where the end product binds. So this end product, it could be used as it is kind of molecule which is acting as a negative feedback system. So now in cases where the end product is available in sufficient amount and no more synthesis is required, so this end product binds to the allosteric site. Now this binding to the allosteric leads to the conformational change in the enzyme. Now this conformational change inhibits the binding of the substrate. However, in another case, if let's say this allosteric end product goes down, it will be automatically removed, and if removed, again there will be conformational change and the active site will be available for the substrate. The enzyme will bind the substrate and the reaction will proceed. So you can see that the level of the end product is dictating the activity of the enzyme. So there's another mechanism also, which is the isoenzyme and feedback inhibition. So some biosynthetic pathways controlled by feedback inhibition employ isoenzyme. Iso means that some enzymes, they are kind of available in different forms. Or you can say that there are different enzymes which kind of catalyze the same reaction. So here you can see that phosphoenolpyruvate and the erythrose 4-phosphate is catalyzed by three different enzymes. So these three different enzymes leads to the formation of 3-deoxy-D-arabinohexylglucosonate 7-phosphate, or in short DAPH. Now this DAPH leads to the formation of orosinate that ultimately leads to the synthesis of three different amino acids. So now these three different amino acids, they need to be produced in sufficient amounts. Only then these three different will act as the three different sources. So if let's say only one amino acid is produced in sufficient amount and two are lacking, then this will not stop the synthesis of DAPH. Why? Because two, three other are also required. So unless these three amino acids are synthesized in sufficient amount, you will not see the feedback inhibition system. This enzyme regulation by covalent modification. So some biosynthetic enzymes are regulated by covalent modification. That is the attachment or removal of some small molecules to the protein. So let's see this one example here. So in this particular, which is the glutamate, this glutamine synthase, in this particular enzyme we have AMP. So we can have 6 molecules of AMP binding together, and we can have 12 molecules of AMP binding. So if we look at this particular graph here, you can see the number of AMP groups added, and this is the level of glutamine synthesis. So if we see that there are more and more AMPs are binding, so the glutamine synthesis goes. So initially the enzyme activity was quite high when the glutamine was low. So as the enzyme glutamine level goes up, the enzyme activity goes down, and that is kind of dictated by the binding of the AMP. So in a way, what I mean to say is that some molecules, they could facilitate the activity of the overall enzymes. So if these are removed, these molecules are removed, let's say in place of 12, you can have less AMP groups attached, then the enzyme returns to the active state. So initially, when more AMP was found, it was quite active, keeps on binding, and they also AMP synthesis increases. So as more and more AMP are attached, this becomes less. Okay, so this is all that I want to discuss. So thank you very much for your time.